The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you today. Just have a few announcements to share with you regarding the service for today. In a little bit, we're going to be singing a hymn, Ubi Caritas, and Elizabeth and Carrie are going to sing through it two times in Latin. And if you'd like to join them, you're welcome to do that. Otherwise, we will then sing it two times in English. But during the prayers of the people, we're going to be singing, Lord, listen to your children praying. And so it's printed in your bulletin, but we will sing that together. And then at the end of the service, when we have the stripping of the altar, at the back of your bulletin is this description of the significance of each of the elements that we'll be carrying out and kind of why we do that. And then just a reminder, if you'd like to join us tomorrow at 11 o'clock, we'll have a dramatic reading of the Passion story of Jesus, and then we'll have one service on Easter morning at 9 o'clock, and invite you to join us for that as well. As we continue with our Maundy Thursday service, I invite you to join with me in singing my song, Is Love Unknown? We'll sing verses 1, 2, 3, and 4. 1, 2, 3, and 4. Friends in Christ, in this Lenten season, we have heard Jesus' parables and stories on Sundays, and then reflected about evangelism and how to share our stories on Wednesdays. We are called to share our stories, and sometimes we are scared to do so. Sometimes, instead of sharing our stories and living in God's love, we do the opposite. For all our harms that we have caused, either by our actions or lack of action, we confess our sins before God and to one another. Loving and merciful God, we do not always understand what you sacrifice so that we might have life. We do not always appreciate how much you gave for us. We do not always remember that you are for us and we are part of your ongoing story. Forgive us the many ways we diminish your sacrifice by our apathy, Forgive us for choosing not to share our story and your story. Forgive our thoughts, words, and actions for the sake of the sacrificial Lamb, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our God holds no grudges. Receive today the entire forgiveness of all your sins given to you by the selfless actions of our holy King, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And again, just a reminder, Carrie and Elizabeth will sing through two times in Latin, and then we will sing in English. Let us pray. God of all that is right and good, heal our bodies and souls with the refreshing gift of your body and blood, given freely for all for the glory of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I invite you now to please join in reading responsibly with me our psalm for today from Psalm 116. How shall I repay the Lord? I will lift the cup of salvation
and call on the name of the Lord.
I will fulfill my vows to the Lord
in the presence of all God's people.
Precious is your sight, O Lord.
Is the death of your servants.
Savior, raise on.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew. On the first day of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus saying, "Where do you want us to make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?" He said, "Go into the city to a certain man and say to him, 'The teacher says, my time is near. I will keep the Passover at your house with my disciples.' So the disciples did as Jesus had directed them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he took his place with the 12, and while they were eating, he said, 'Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me.' And they became greatly agitated, and they began to say to him one after another, 'Surely not I, Lord.' He answered, 'The one who has dipped his hand into the bowl with me will betray me. The Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to that one by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would be better for that one to have not been born.' Judas, who betrayed him, said, 'Surely not I, Rabbi.' He replied, 'You have said so.' While they were eating, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it and broke it, he gave it to his disciples and he said, 'Take, eat, this is my body.' Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them saying, 'Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which I poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I would tell you, I will never again drink of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it anew with you in my Father's kingdom.' When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives." The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Gracious Jesus, on this solemn day, help us through the presence and the power of your Spirit to more deeply live into and experience your passion. Guide us, Lord, into a deeper understanding of the depth of your love for us and for this world and what you have done, so that we might be set free from sin and death and rise anew with you on Easter morning. Thank you for the gift of this meal that you shared with your disciples and that you share with us today. And as we eat of the bread and partake of the wine, let us not only remember who you are and what you have done, but let us taste and experience your grace and become instruments of your grace to whom all your Spirit sends us to. In your holy name we pray, amen. A while ago, I was reading a book by Jean Vanier. As a young man back in the 1960s, God opened his eyes to different groups of people that were suffering on the margins of society around him. But God not only gave him the eyes to see the suffering of others with compassion, but God also gave him a vision. So in 1964, he founded a small network of homes for people who were afflicted with severe mental and physical disabilities. He wanted these individuals to live with other otherwise normal and healthy individuals, and he called this new community L'Arche, which literally means the Ark. And so two by two, side by side, these two different groups of people came together and formed a community. And they walked with each other through sad times and times of joy and struggle and the storms of life. When John first created these new communities, he focused on addressing the physical and the mental disabilities that these people were struggling with in their life. But he soon realized that there was an even deeper healing that needed to take place, and it had to do with the pain that comes with loneliness. He writes, When I started welcoming those with physical and intellectual disabilities into L'Arche, men and women from institutions, psychiatric hospital, dysfunctional families, I began to realize how truly lonely they were. I discovered the terrible feeling of chaos that comes from extreme loneliness. When we step back and when we think about it in our own lives, we realize that loneliness can come upon us at any time and in many different ways. It comes in times of sickness or when our friends are absent. It comes during sleepless nights when our hearts are heavy or they're filled with anxiety. Do you remember those times? When you can't sleep and you're staring up at the ceiling. Times of failure at work, maybe at school, in our relationships. It comes when we lose trust in ourselves and we lose trust in others. It comes when we age or we wait for the next text, the next tweet, or the Facebook post. We can even hear it in the voice of Jesus as he cries out from the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? Maybe today some of you are struggling with feelings of loneliness. If so, you're not alone. In a recent study, 70% of Americans said that they feel lonely on a regular basis. Doesn't that seem strange when millions and millions of people are constantly connected through social media? But sadly and ironically, the people who spend most of their time on social media also reported that they felt the most lonely and the most depressed. And I wonder about our kids. I wonder how they feel. Virtually their whole life is on social media or iPhones. And what troubles me is research has shown is that the more that kids spend on social media and the more time they spend on iPhones and such, that they're losing the interpersonal skills that they need to experience loving and caring relationships with others or the ability to be in community. Have you ever seen a group of kids hanging out with each other? It's like this. And when I talk to kids, I would say it's at least 70% that feel lonely most of the time. But we're not alone. Loneliness seems to be an epidemic throughout the industrialized world. In fact, back in 2017, the British government appointed a minister of loneliness. It would be similar to a cabinet position in our own president's cabinet. And it was a response to this crisis of loneliness and how it was affecting people at a very deep level. One of their ministers had said, young or old, loneliness doesn't discriminate. Throughout 2017, he said, we have heard from new parents, children, disabled people, caregivers, refugees, and older people about their experience with loneliness. And the costs are enormous. People who are lonely have a shorter lifespan and they have more medical illnesses. They're more prone to substance abuse or mental health issues. In addition, they're more susceptible to suicide and violence. Again, how many times have we heard about the mental crisis because of the pandemic of people being socially isolated from one another and the cost that it's taking on them? What we also see is that people who have expressed not only bullying and rejection and being marginalized, but out of that sense of isolation and loneliness can come not only a sense of hopelessness, but is one of the things that fuels so much of the violence that we see in our society today. Again, Jean Vanier writes, loneliness can become such uncontrolled anguish that one can slip easily into the chaos of madness. No wonder some people who are desperately lonely lose themselves in mental illness and violence. And that's why this day is so sacred and it's so special. Because so many years ago, even though Jesus knew in a matter of hours he was going to experience a horrific death, and even though on this day he could already feel the weight of the sin of the world and evil coming down upon him, what we see in the Passion story on this Thursday when he gathers with his disciples is that he is more concerned about their well-being than his own. He knew that they were going to go through times in their life when they were going to feel overwhelmed, and that they were going to go through times in their life where they were going to feel abandoned and utterly alone. So he wanted to give them something that was sacred and holy, something that they could hold in their hands, something that they could taste that would not only remind them that he was still with them, but that they would also feel his presence through the power of the Holy Spirit when they ate of the bread and drank of the wine, in, with, and under, as Martin Luther said. On that night when he was gathered with his disciples, he made a promise to them, and he makes a promise to you today. He says, I will never leave you as orphaned or alone. But he says, especially when you're overwhelmed, especially when you're lonely, I will find you, and I will send my Holy Spirit to you, the Comforter, who will remind you of everything that I have said to you, and I give you a peace that the world cannot give. So do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid, for I am with you. That same gift and presence and peace is offered to us every time that we eat of the bread and drink of the wine, trusting in the promise of Jesus that he is faithful to do what he has said, to be present, to accept us, to love us, to forgive us, and to be with us. And it is through this outpouring of love that Jesus also gathers us into community, creates community as he gathers him, gathers us to himself. You are a witness to that truth. We are gathered here today in relationship with one another because of who Jesus is and because of what Jesus has done for us. And what makes this gathering so different from a social gathering is that not only is Jesus present, but as we take in the bread and the wine with the faith that the Spirit gives us, it becomes almost like a supernatural medicine that changes us and transforms us from the inside out, so that we become instruments of God's grace to one another. Just like Jesus has sought us out and gathered us together, just like with Jean Vanier, all of a sudden our eyes are opened up in a new way. And we not only see the suffering of people around us, but God gives us the courage. God gives us the wisdom and the grace to meet people where they are at, in their darkness and in their loneliness, and to invite them into this new community that Jesus Christ is establishing for us today. That's the truth that Jean Vanier witnessed at L'Arche. And when we become instruments of that grace, individual lives are woven into a beautiful tapestry of God's love. In such a community, there are no strangers. We are all brothers and sisters in Christ. Amen. Please join with me now in singing our hymn of the day, O Living Bread of Heaven, number 542. Let us now join in professing our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As we pray today, we will sing, Lord, listen to your children praying, after each petition. Now confident that God acts on our behalf, we pray for the church, the world, and all those who are in need. United by the servant love of God in Christ, we pray for this holy day, for the needs of the world. You call your people to hand on what we receive from you. Form all the baptized into teachers of faith. Form one generation to the next. Give your church hunger for your promises and the sacraments and enjoy in receiving and sharing your word. Lord, listen to your children praying. You redeemed your people from slavery, preserved people throughout the world who flee violence and oppression, established just leadership in places of tyranny, and peace in place of war. Jesus loved his followers to the end. Grant assurance of that love to all who need it, those living with guilt, those struggling to forgive, those who are lonely or overlooked. Heal the sick and embrace the dying. Lord, listen to your children praying.
Lord, listen to your children praying. Lord, send your spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us power, send us grace.
Your glory shone in the suffering, death, and resurrection of Jesus. We thank you for generations of faithful who have proclaimed our Lord's death. Unite us with them in the hope until he comes again. Lord, listen to your children praying. Let us pray. God of glory, receive these gifts and the offering of our lives. As Jesus was lifted up from the earth, draw us to your heart in the midst of this world, that all creation may be brought from bondage to freedom, from darkness to light, from death to life, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, gave thanks, and broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Again, after supper, he took the cup, and after he had given thanks, he gave it for all people to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. It is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of their sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Jesus, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Jesus and his friends gathered around the table. You too are welcome to come. Eat and drink, for all is ready. All are welcome. Come. We're going to listen to Carrie and Elizabeth to sing Pai Jesu, and then I'll invite you to come forward to share in this meal. The table of the Lord is now prepared. Come and share in Christ's gift for you today. Please join with me in our post-communion prayer. Lord Jesus, in a wonderful sacrament, you strengthen us with the saving power of your suffering, death, and resurrection. May this sacrament of your body and blood so work in us that the fruits of your redemption will show forth in the way we live. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Let us now depart in the grace and peace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.